The rules may soon be changing about what you can go to jail for and for how long in Massachusetts. But as they say, the devil is in the details. Last month, the Senate passed the criminal justice reform package that would, among other elements, eliminate mandatory minimum sentences for certain drug crimes, including low-level trafficking. But now House leaders are weighing in with some different ideas. While their bill would get rid of mandatory minimum sentencing in some drug offenses, those caught trafficking any amount of drugs would still be subject to the required sentences. The House also does not touch two other issues passed in the Senate version, which would legalize sex between teenagers close in age and raise the age where you're no longer considered a juvenile from 18 to 19. The issues are not only dividing lawmakers, but some of the state's top prosecutors as well, with 9 out of the 11 district attorneys raising strong concerns about parts of the Senate's approach. So where does the reform effort go from here? Joining me are State Senator Sonia Chang-Diaz of Boston, who serves as vice chair of the Joint Committee on the Judiciary. Nice to see you, Senator.
Thanks,
and Dan Connolly is district attorney for Suffolk County, who is one of the prosecutors who signed that letter. District Attorney, it's good to see you, too.
Good to see you, Jim.
Can I start with you here? Mandatory minimums, you and your colleagues want to eliminate them, as I said, for many crimes. Short version, which ones and why? What's the argument?
Our argument has been to eliminate mandatory minimums on nonviolent drug offenses, simply put, because they are expensive and they don't work. We have,
How do they not work?
Well, I represent, Jim, as you know, one of the districts in the state that is most heavily impacted by crime and violence and the drug trade. And so if there were evidence over the last 30 or 40 years when mandatory minimums have been popular, I would probably be here defending them, right? I talk every week with moms who are sick of needles littering their park. I have gone to more funerals of 14-year-olds than I care to count. And these are the people and these are the stories that I carry in my heart as I've been working on a criminal justice reform, because it's the system has become as much a perpetrator as a protector. And we're seeing this cycle of intergenerational harm that's increasing the increasing risks and harm for our community. And that's really what I'm in it for.
D.A. Connolly, where's she wrong about this? And by the way, as you know, the vast majority of her colleagues are where she is, in the Senate.
Well, you know, in the Senate, if you drill down, actually, and I watched a lot of the debate, a lot of the amendments around mandatory minimum sentences were relatively close. I mean, the bill passed with a substantial margin, but there seems to be conflict in the Senate over some of the more controversial aspects of the
bill. Well, what's wrong with low-level drug offense? Set aside the trafficking inclusion in one case. What's wrong with getting rid of the bulk of these things where the House and the Senate agree?
So low-level, I agree with Sonia, there should be no mandatory minimum sentences for low-violent, non-drug offenders.
So where's the problem?
So we don't do that. So in other words, you're not subjected really to mandatory minimum sentences unless you're trafficking or you've been dealing with drugs at least a second time. So if you're distributing cocaine, for example, for the second time, then you are subjected to a mandatory minimum sentence.
So does that mean that the House version, which has excluded this trafficking provision, is one? Yeah. You and your 8 colleagues who signed that letter will just sign on to vis-a-vis mandatory minimums?
If I'm correct, both the House and the Senate agree that people who sell drugs for second and subsequent time ought not to be subject to a minimum sentence.
Yeah,
I said I was open to that concept, and you know, if that's the will of the legislature, then that's what we're going to have to deal with.
Yeah, but one last thing for you, I was talking to the head of the Civil Liberties Union today, and says one of the problems with and they're obviously with Senator Chang-Diaz and her colleagues on this. What's the incentive for a prisoner to get involved in a treatment program and a good time program if they know that there's a mandatory minimum?
There's none.
Where's the incentive for?
There's no incentive, but that's...
Don't you want there to be one?
Of course I do, and that's something I support and I've always supported. So, you know, that's part of both bills as well, and you're going to get support. You know, there's probably a lot more things that we agree on, Jim.
You two were going to be screaming at each other about this.
No.
It sounds to me like if you sat down with him, I don't mean just you, you could strike a deal on mandatory minimums like this. Is that not?
Maybe we should go in a room and see if we can get it done.
Okay, but well, maybe. But can I stay on it for a second? If why not? Should they be eliminated? Why don't you go further? Did you not go further because of concern of DAs? Why did you not go?
Well, look, I think what we saw in the Senate is that we had 27 votes, two-thirds of the Senate who were willing to say, yes, we need to make big fundamental reforms to our system. The system is deeply broken, deep racial disparities in our sentencing outcomes, deep intergenerational harm. I think where you see the disagreement come into play is around this word of trafficking, right? And there's a lot of confusion about what does trafficking mean? I think when you say trafficking, people picture like, you know, a drug kingpin, and nobody wants that person to be out roaming.
And cut a deal that they can live with and then build on that. Isn't that the common sense way to go?
Because because look, people are so frustrated when they hear that you and me and all of your viewers, we are all spending north of $50,000 a year per person to lock people up.
So it's about the money, too.
And that's money that we could be spending on things that we know are more effective.
Well, here's the irony on that one, right? Because the prison population has been declining steeply in the last 5 years, but the expenditures on the Department of Correction, the sheriffs, have gone up 18%.
So what does that indicate to you?
What that indicates to me is there is not a dime or a thin dime's worth of savings when you do these changes. We did massive changes in 2018. The prison population went down 26%, and they didn't save one.
So what are they stealing money? I mean, there's got to be something.
The $50,000 number that Sonia just referred to is really a fantasy. It doesn't. If the building is open, it has to be heated. It has to have prison guards. It has to have programming. It has to have everything.
So there's no savings by reducing the prison population.
There's like a marginal cost of about $4,000 a prisoner, which they are not realizing. And that's a question that needs to be asked of the sheriffs, and that's a question that needs to be asked of the Department of
Corrections. We also need to put this in bigger perspective,
quickly,
right?
Please.
If we just talk about the last 5 years, we're missing a big piece of the picture, which is that if you look over the last 40 years, in Massachusetts, we are locking up 4 to 5 times as many people as we used to. We are not 4 to 5 times worse as a people in Massachusetts than
we
were.
And your belief is the most serious impact is on people of color. Is that
yes,
not
absolutely.
And do you agree with that?
8,600 people are in the state prison system right now. The DOC classifies 70% of them as violent offenders, okay? More than 50% of them are Caucasians.
How's that?
There is.
So you don't think there is racial disparity?
There is racial disparity. There's no question. They are not represented. So the blacks and Latinos are represented at a higher percentage in the DOC. But you know what? Sonia's the only Latina in the state Senate. There's disparities everywhere. There's disparities in education. There's disparities
in poverty.
You can
agree that doesn't make it okay.
No, but you have to drill down and find out why. Why is that the case? And I will tell you, one reason is the cities that are responsible for the prison population, primarily the top 10 cities, are cities like Boston and Springfield and Lawrence and Holyoke that are majority minority cities. You have to look at
the
root
causes. So you either
think
there is a disparity or there isn't. You seem to be saying there's not a disparity because of where they come from.
There is a disparity if all you're saying is there are more blacks and Latinos in the DOC than at the population at large. But what you have to find out is why. Why is that happening?
What's the answer?
The answer is the root causes of crime. People are not predisposed to be criminals because of their race or their ethnicity. They are, however, more at risk if they are living in environments where there is low educational attainment, where there is poverty,
but
where there is no...
We have larger disparities in Massachusetts than... We have the single highest disparity between white and Latino residents.
Despite the fact that those conditions obtain in many cities around the country.
Those conditions exist
everywhere.
So how
do you explain it? You say it's just outright discrimination.
Look, there is systemic racism, no question. And it's not an individual. I wouldn't point to Dan Connolly or any other DA.
Are DAs responsible for it?
It's part of it. This is a 30 to 40 year problem that we're looking at. So there's no one person, but you have to stop and recognize the system is broken.
Yeah, I want to step back for a second. In the letter that you and Ada, your colleague, signed, you said this bill, Senate bill, largely ignores the interests of victims of crime. Is that a rhetorical flourish, or do you actually think that what they drafted, even where you disagree, ignores...
Well, it was 124 pages when they filed it. It was 175 pages when they engrossed it.
What's it got to do with ignoring
the I don't see the word victim anywhere.
So does that mean they're ignoring
victims?
That's
flat out not correct.
I mean, basically, there's nothing in there that addresses the rights and the concerns and the needs of victims.
Quickly.
I'm entirely in this for the victims. Moms who are talking to me about the needles in their parks, grandparents who are on their second generation of children that they're raising because you can go whole city blocks in my neighborhoods where you don't meet a family that's not touched by the system. Those people are all victims. And, I would urge you and the 9 other DAs to read the bill that left the Senate floor. I guarantee you the word victim appears in that bill. There's at least one amendment that I can think of. And if it is not written in so many words,
well, you
it is
urge
100%
them to read. Can I urge one
embedded.
Thing, too? That everybody sit down and cut a deal is my position. And unfortunately, we can't get to all the other stuff, but we will soon, I promise. Senator, nice to see you. DA, pleasure. Thank you so much for your time.